My name is Daniel Goldsmith, and I'm a Holocaust survivor. And today I'm going to tell you the story of my family, my father, my mother, my sister, and myself. This is a short version of the period of 1939 through 1945, when my sister was just about born to about 6 years old, and I was about 8 years to almost 14 years old. First, some background information. We lived in Belgium, and on the map, you see in red, Europe. Incidentally, this is a map that I drew back in 1947, and that is the reason why it's in French. And Belgium is that little triangle right there above France, next to Germany, and below Holland. Belgium is about the size of the state of Maryland. And at the time of World War II, there were approximately 65,000 Jewish people living in Belgium. We lived in the Jewish section in Antwerp. My parents were Chaim and Rochel Goldschmidt. This is their wedding picture. They came originally from Poland in the late 1920s as single people, met in Antwerp, and married there in 1930. My parents were middle-class people. My father was a plumber, and he had his own business. And my mother was a homemaker. My parents were religious. They were Orthodox. In addition to that, my parents were also multilingual in that they spoke French and Flemish, which are the two official languages in Belgium, and also spoke German, Polish, and Russian. Then 1 year later, on December 11, 1931, I was born, and I do remember a normal, happy early childhood. Here's another picture. This is a picture taken of my father, my mother, and myself when I was a couple of years old. And then at the age of 6 and a half, my parents sent me to an all-day Hebrew school. So the first thing I want to explain to you are some of these pictures. Some of the pictures are old pictures that my mother was able to save, and some of these pictures, like this one, are pictures that I took when I went back to Belgium to retrace my step 40 years later. So I came here in 1948, and I went back to Belgium in 1988. One of the remarkable things about that particular picture is, look at the entrance. It's fortified. It has stanchions, it has concrete blocks. It's got a security camera, it's got metal gates. And I could not get into the school. This is my kindergarten picture. Being a religious school, this is the only time that boys and girls were together. This is my kindergarten teacher, and I'm standing right there between the two girls. The next picture is my first grade picture. And as you can notice over here, they're all boys, and I'm sitting right there in the front row. And then on December 25, 1939, my sister Lillian was born. World War II started on September 1, 1939, when Germany invaded Poland. And so her birth to us was a bright spot in what looked to be a bleak world. And now to my story, and at this point I'm 8 years old. Belgium was invaded by the Germans on May 10th, 1940, and our family, along with thousands of other people from Belgium, fled on foot towards northern France to try to escape the Germans, but unfortunately, they caught up with us before we got into France. And when they caught up with us, they made everybody turn around and go back wherever they came from. So we went back to Antwerp, where my parents tried to reestablish a normal life, but it only lasted a very, very short time. Because very soon, the anti-Jewish decrees and regulations and restrictions were issued. And here they are in chronological order. October 23, 1940, ritual slaughter was prohibited. Ritual slaughter meaning making kosher, killing the animals the kosher way. October 28, 1940, Jews had to register with the Germans and were eliminated from public and administration, the legal and teaching professions. On April 14th, 1941, the only pogrom occurred in Antwerp. A pogrom is a riot against Jewish people only. And Jewish shops were destroyed, two main synagogues were looted, Torah scrolls were burnt in the streets, but this was done by pro-Nazi Flemish people. May 31, 1941, Jews had to display signs identifying Jewish-owned enterprises, and non-Jewish people were encouraged not to patronize those stores. We had to declare our capital and other assets and were restricted to withdraw only a fixed amount from our bank accounts. August 18, 1941, the Nazis started the unilateral confiscation of the portion of the diamond industry that was owned by the Jewish people. August 29, 1941, a curfew was set for Jews between 7 p.m. and 7 a.m., thereby restricting freedom of movement. Jews could no longer enter public places. Imagine that. We couldn't go to a park. We couldn't go to the movies. We couldn't go to a museum. Any public place, we couldn't go there anymore. And Jews could only live in the four largest cities, which were Brussels, Antwerp, Liège, and Charleroi. November 25, 1941, all Jewish children were expelled from public schools. January 17, 1942, Jews were forbidden to leave Belgium. March 11, 1942, the Nazis imposed a special forced labor on the Jews. May 27, 1942, all Jews had to wear a yellow star. So as you can see, little by little, in a very calculated way, the Nazis stripped us of our civil and economic rights. And it took only about 1.5 years to accomplish this feat. It was very well planned and executed, and to us, it was incredibly demoralizing. And it was under these orders and regulations and restrictions that we tried to live as best as we could, which was becoming hard, because food was becoming scarce. Because of the restrictions, my father had less and less work, thereby diminishing our income. Life became tense at home because we stayed mostly cooped up, since we were not allowed to go places that we were used to. And the best that we could do was to visit friends. And so in August 1942, My father received a notice in the mail to go to northern France. And I remember my parents talking about what actions to take, because I was in the kitchen at the time that my parents were discussing it. And it turns out that my father's view prevailed. He was young. He was only 39. He was in very good health. He felt he could survive a labor camp. But what my father and my mother did not know at that particular time, and incidentally, most people in the world did not know about these things at that particular time. There were two things. One was called the Final Solution, which was the total destruction of the European people in Europe. And the second one was the existence of the concentration camps. At that particular time, the Nazis kept it very secret, and we didn't know about it. Let me show you some more pictures. This is the last picture of my baby sister Lillian and I before things got very bad in 1942. This is a copy of a yellow star that we had to wear. And so, my father, along with thousands of other Jews, reported to the train station at the appointed time. This is a picture of the train station in Antwerp. It's a huge train station. You can see it's glass-domed, many tracks leading into it. And we reported at the train station, which was August 15th, 1942. We went there to say goodbye to him, and I'll never forget the parting scene over there. There were thousands of people saying goodbye to their loved ones, a lot of hugging, a lot of crying. But in particular, I remember what my father told me. And I'm repeating his words to you, word for word. He said, "You're the little man in the house now, and so you'll have to take care of your mother and your sister until I come back." And I told him I would. I took it very seriously. And this is really the day I lost my childhood, and I was only 10 years old. A little later, we received a postcard from my father. As you can see on the postcard, it's addressed to the street that we lived, 34 Korte Kievitstraat, Antwerp. Also notice the German cancellation stamp in the middle. But in the upper right corner, there's a French cancellation stamp, which says Pas de Calais. And Pas de Calais, indeed, was a city in northern France where my father was nearby. In the back of the postcard, he writes, by the way, that's in Flemish in the back, and he writes that he's near Boulogne, which was near Calais, and Guten van alle, which means greetings to everybody, and that's all that we received from him. Back home, gradually it became more difficult to live day by day. The restrictions were in full force, and by that time, my mother had little money left. So she started selling some of my father's tools just to have money to buy food and to take care of our home. However, my mother was a very special person. She also had great foresight. Even though we lived in the Jewish section of Antwerp, the street that we lived on, which was Korte Kievitstraat, was half Jewish and half non-Jewish. And we had some very, very, very good non-Jewish friends. And what my mother did is she gave one non-Jewish family some of our pictures, which you're seeing now. So she gave another family our silverware. And the third family got some of my father's more expensive tools, all to be returned after the war, which indeed they did. Then in September 1942, the street that we lived on got raided by the Nazis in the middle of the night. When everybody was sleeping, the Nazis came in and sealed off both ends of the street with trucks and started pulling out the Jewish people from their homes, starting at each end of the street. Now remember, it was very easy for them because we had registered and they knew exactly where we lived. We lived at 34 Korte Kivitzat, and this is a picture of my house that I took 40 years later after I went back to revisit Antwerp. But I took this picture in a certain way, and I would like to explain that to you. From here to here is number 34 Korte Kivitzat. But when I went back, the house had been renovated within that period of time. And you can see there's an overhang, a cornice there, which had been removed in my, what used to be my house. So, also fortunately for us, number 34 Korte Kivitzat was closer to the center of the street. When they started pulling out people from their houses at each end of the street, there was a lot of noise, a lot of yelling, and a lot of screaming, a great commotion. That woke my mother up, and she looked outside the bedroom window, and that's the bedroom window right there. And she saw what was happening, and she quickly grabbed my baby sister, a blanket, and myself. And we went all the way to the rear of the house, to the upper floor, where there was a metal ladder that was attached to the wall leading up to a skylight onto the roof. It was a flat roof. And we went onto the roof, my mother closed the skylight, and then we walked from the rear of the house all the way to the front of the house, and we lay down underneath that cornice, which was here, similar to that. We lay down here. And as soon as we got there, as a little kid, I was very curious. So as we got there, and I quickly looked over the cornice is only about a couple of feet high, and I actually saw people being dragged in their night clothes, no luggage, nothing, and being put in the truck. But that's all I saw for a second, because my mother quickly grabbed me and pulled me down and put me under the blanket with my baby sister and, of course, and herself. And we lay there shivering, actually literally shivering, you know, not knowing what was going to happen to us. So we lay there for a while until suddenly we heard banging on our door, and then there were sounds of crashing, which meant that the door was broken in, and broken down, I should say. Then we heard more noise, which turned out to be that the Germans, when they got inside the house, trashed the whole house, but they didn't find us. However, one German soldier went up that ladder. And what he did is he opened up the skylight, and he just put his head through the skylight. And it was very dark in that roof, so he had a flashlight, and he looked around. But because he was here at the rear of the house, and we were 35 feet away in the front of the house under the blanket, he did not see us. And so he closed the skylight, went back down. Then we heard some more banging, which turned out that they boarded up the front of the house so nobody could get in or out. And we lay there on the roof until my mother was sure that the raid was over. Now, I'm somewhat religious, and I believe a small miracle happened that night. And the miracle was that my baby sister Lillian slept through that whole commotion. I don't know how else to explain it. But she slept through the whole commotion. If she had woken up, if she had cried, if she had made any noise, I know we would have been caught. And I would not be here to tell the story. So we stayed on the roof until my mother was absolutely sure the raid was over. And we went back inside. And my mother lost it. I mean, the whole inside of the house was trashed. Furniture was broken, pots and pans all over the place, food smeared over the walls. And my mother sat down on the bed and cried for a while until she was finally able to compose herself. And then she decided to go see one of our friends, a non-Jewish friend. He was a policeman in Antwerp and also a member of the Belgium Underground. And so to explain to you what the Belgium Underground was, it was a group of people that banded together secretly to fight the Nazis. But she couldn't go out the front of the house because the house had been boarded up. So she went out to the back of the house. Behind our house was a little garden, and the garden butted up against the train tracks leading into the train station. And on the other side of the train tracks was the street. And that's how she went out, walked around the block, went to see our friend, and came back later on that night and told me that she had made arrangements for us to be hidden. So the next night, at the appointed time, my mother smuggled us out of the house again the same way through the back of the house. But this time there was a car waiting in the street, and the car took us out of town to a Catholic convent where my mother dropped us off. Only Mother Superior knew who we were. No one else. None of the other sisters, none of the other children, none of the other workers. And my mother left. Now, I'm going to tell you something about my mother. My mother could not talk about the Holocaust. It was very, very difficult. It was extremely emotional. She had a very, very hard time talking about it. And it took me many, many years, I'm talking about over 20 years, for me to find out little pieces of information. It's a little piece here and a little piece there to be able to put a story together. And part of the information that I found out many, many years later was that when my mother dropped us off at the convent, she went back to Antwerp and she joined the Belgium Underground. And she became a courier, a messenger. So now my sister and I, we stayed in the convent for a few months. It actually turned out to be around Christmas time, 1942, when suddenly my mother shows up to take us out. Why was she there? And the reason was that she had found out through the Belgium Underground, which apparently had very, very good contacts, that she had found out that the Nazis were going to raid that convent. So she wanted to get us out, and at the same time told Mother Superior that if she was hiding any other Jewish children there, to get rid of them. Because at that particular time, the edict was that if you were caught hiding Jews, you would be shot immediately. And I truly believe by this one little action that my mother saved a few lives. So she took us away and brought us to another gentleman's house. He was also a member of the Underground. His name was Mr. Goossens. And she left us there, my sister and I, until she was able to find another hiding place for us. It took a little while, but she did. And she decided to split us up. My sister went to live with a private Catholic family. This is a picture with the family there, and this is my sister right there. As you can see, she blended in quite well with the other family. You know, they had three other children. And the cover story was that she was a distant member of the family that went to live with them temporarily during the war, which was quite common in those days. I, on the other hand, I went to live in a boys' orphanage, a Catholic orphanage, in a little village called Weelde, which was right on the border between Belgium and Holland. And this is the picture that I took when I went back 40 years later. The building is still there, except it was no longer an orphanage. It was actually a place for homeless people. And this wonderful human being took care of me. This is Father Ivor Cornelissen. Ivor Cornelissen. He was a Catholic priest who ran three orphanages in Belgium. And as you can see, the orphanage was in the country. He did a couple of things for me right away. The first thing that he did for me is he changed my name. And my name became Willie Peters, which is a typical Belgian name. And the second thing that he did is he gave me false baptismal papers, so that if anybody would ask me, I would be able to show, you know, that I was Catholic, and here's the document. In addition to that, I also went to school over there, and I learned farming and how to raise animals. And the school that I went to, incidentally, was a parochial school. Now, I stayed there for a few months until Father Cornelissen felt that it was too dangerous for me to stay in one place too long. And remember, I had mentioned that he ran three different orphanages. So this was in the Flemish part of Belgium. He sent me to an orphanage in the French part of Belgium. And there, I continued going to parochial school. I went to church every day. And I even became an altar boy. And all this was to blend in with the rest of the boys. However, in May 1944, we got raided by the Nazis. And incidentally, I never found out how that happened. But we got raided by the Nazis, and I was caught. And the way I was caught was, since it was a boys' orphanage, they made us all undress naked, and only the Jewish boys were circumcised. So I'd like to explain that to you, that today a thing like that cannot happen anymore because many non-Jewish boys get circumcised for medical reasons. But in those days, in Europe, only Jewish boys get circumcised. So that's how I was caught. And that's also when I found out that there were five other Jewish boys there. We all kept it very, very secret from each other. So from there, we were taken to prisons. Actually, I wound up in three different prisons. And in the very last prison, suddenly, in the middle of the night, they rounded up a whole bunch of kids, you know, and they put us on a freight train. This is a sample freight train. It's not a passenger train. And I just wanted to show that to you so you can see what they put us in there. It's a freight train. And as soon as we got onto that freight train, the oldest boy, whose name was Joseph, he was only 16 years old. He kind of became our leader. And he urged us to escape from the train. How were we going to escape? But he had a plan. He was 16, but also quite tall for his age. And he was the only one that wore long pants. And underneath his pants, he had a pair of boots. And in one of the boots, he had a piece of steel this long. Actually, that little piece of steel was going to be used as a weapon to protect himself, if needed be. But actually what he did is he went ahead and he pried away from the side of the train pieces of wood to make an opening large enough for himself. So this is what's going on while the train was moving. And when he finished making the opening, he said the following to us. He says, if the train stops, or if the train slows down enough, he says, I will push you out one by one. And the only advice that I can give you is when you jump out of the train, roll away from the tracks in order to minimize getting hurt. And so at one point, the train did not stop, but did slow down enough because it was a very sharp bend. And he said, that's it. And he pushed us out one by one, and all of us escaped from the train. When the train was gone, we had to do a couple of things. First of all, we had to find everybody, because remember, this is in the middle of the night, it was quite dark. And we did find everybody over this long stretch. Secondly, we had to check everybody to find out if there were any broken bones or anything major. And fortunately, there were only sprains and bleeding cuts. And that was very, very good news. And by that time, incidentally, it was getting to be dawn, and the light was coming up in the distance, and we saw woods in the distance, and we decided to go and hide in the woods. Once we got into the woods, we realized something interesting. We didn't know where we were. So Joseph decided to venture out again at night so he would not be seen. And he says, I'll try to find out where we are. And he came back the very next day and he said that he thought that we were in the French-speaking part of Belgium because he had seen a sign of a village called Perway. And that sounds French. That was great news. But then a day or two later, things got very, very, very bad. We had no food, we had no water, the sprains were getting worse, the cuts were getting infected, and we just didn't know what to do. And we were looking to Joseph, you know, for guidance. You know, we were much younger than he was. So finally, he decided to do something very, very dangerous, and at the same time, very, very courageous. He decided to go back into the village of Perway and go to the rectory next to the Catholic Church and speak to the priest and tell him about us. Now that was very, very dangerous because the priest could have said, I'm sorry, I cannot help you. Or the priest could have said, just a moment, you know, and called the Germans and turned us in. But he didn't. He was very receptive to help us. It took a little while, but he came up with a plan where he put each one of us with a family, a Catholic family, each one of us went to different Catholic families in the village, and the plan was so secretive, nobody knew who was where. Each family thought they had the only Jewish child, and only the priest knew where everybody was. This is where I went to. From here to here is 13 Rue de l'Église in the village of Perway, and I was hidden up here in the attic. These are the people that hid me. Monsieur Bautier, Madame Bautier, very, very devout Catholic people, wonderful human beings, their daughter Fernande and their daughter Madeleine. And that's Madeleine. Madeleine was 18, Fernande was 20. And this is the attic they hid me. This is a picture of the attic when I went back 40 years later. As amazingly, the attic was still the same, totally unfinished. The only thing that had been replaced was the window, but everything else remained the same. And I had to be absolutely quiet because the village of Peroué was a very small village. Everybody knew everybody else, including everybody else's business. I didn't want to do anything, you know, that would put the Bautiers' lives in jeopardy. So it was very, very quiet. And the only time they would let me out was at night. And this is their backyard. You can see it was a very narrow house, but they had like a 100-foot deep backyard. And you can also see it's surrounded by a wall. So they would let me out at night to get some fresh air. And in addition to that, they were nice enough to buy me a pet rabbit to play with. So they got me a rabbit and a cage, and the cage was attached. There was a tool shed over here, and that was my joy, so to speak, while I was there. Back to my mother. Again, this is information that I found out many, many, many years later. I did not know that my mother had kept track of me, and she had found out that I was caught. So now she wanted to know where I was, was there anything that she could do to help me, etc. And in order to get that information, she would contact a priest in the city of Namur. The priest's name is Father André. Father André was a righteous Gentile. If you go to the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C., at the Righteous Gentile section, there is a big picture of him over there because indeed he saved many lives. So why was my mother going to see him? Number one, he was a member of the Belgium Underground. Number two, he was a Catholic priest. And number three, he had excellent connections with the Germans. So they thought, my mother, I should say, thought that he would be able to find out where I was. So my mother made an appointment to see him. And unfortunately, her timing was awful. The day my mother arrived in the city of Namur to see Father André was the day the Allies bombed the city. And my mother got caught in the air raid, and she completely lost her left leg. It was completely severed from her. And she lay there bleeding. She almost bled to death, but fortunately people found her in the rubble and took her to the hospital in the city of Namur. I was with the Bautier family then for a few months. When we got liberated in the fall of 1944, and just to put this in the historical perspective, there was a big battle that occurred in Belgium in the winter of 1944 called the Battle of the Bulge. The picture over here is the liberation picture of Peroué. Unfortunately, it's the only picture that I have, and it's not a great picture. But you can see an American soldier over here with the uniform, the helmet. He's actually sitting on a jeep, and he's surrounded by people from Peroué. So we got liberated in the fall of 1944. And as soon as we got liberated, the Bautier family was nice enough to start looking for my mother. They brought me to the hospital in Namur. There, I did not recognize my mother. My mother was only 39 years old, but she looked like an old woman. She had white hair. Her complexion was very pale. She was all bones and skin. And this was not my mother. Last time I saw her, you know, she had black hair. She was a pretty hefty-sized woman. But she recognized me. And after talking to me, then I finally did recognize my mother. And it turned out to be a great occasion for us because here we were reunited. My mother was alive. My sister was alive. I was alive. Now all we had to do was to wait for my father to come back and we would be a whole family again. So since the war was over for us, an American organization came into Europe to start pulling out the people from their places. And I was put in a children's home. But before I go to that, this is a wonderful picture. This is Father André. This picture was taken in Namur. Father André not only was a great human being, also was very generous. He lived in the city of Namur. He had a very large house, and he hosted a lot of refugees that were in transit from one place to another. And one of the people that he hosted was my mother. There she is, right there. And you can see my mother's wearing slacks. You see a shoe here, but no shoe there. And the reason she was not wearing a shoe there was because at that particular time, she was healing and she was wearing a peg leg. So to explain that, when you lose your leg, what is left over is called a stump. The stump has to heal, then it's got to shrink down to size, and after that, you can be fitted with an artificial leg. This was before she was fitted with an artificial leg. And then I went to this children's home, which was called the Home de là-bas. It's a very old chateau, which dates back to the 1700s. Half the building were Jewish children, and this half of the building were all American soldiers. They were the truck drivers for what was called then the Red Ball Express. I want you to pay attention to this tower over here, the red tower with the gray stripes. There is the tower with the gray stripes, and that's me. That's what I looked like at age 13, when after liberation. At that particular time, we didn't have proper clothing. These are all hand-me-down clothes. We didn't have proper shoes. We wore these wooden clogs at that time. But that's what I looked like at age 13. When the war ended in May 1945, the American soldiers left, and then after that, more and more children started arriving to fill out the second half of the building. They were Jewish, but they were not from Belgium. They were from Germany and Poland and France and Czechoslovakia, all the other countries that had been conquered by the Germans. All these children that were coming back there were children that were orphans that had been in concentration camps. And that is how we started to learn what had happened during the Holocaust. We didn't know about that. We had major problems. There were approximately 300 children there. Some of us were mentally sick, some of us were physically sick, emotionally sick, and they realized that we needed more private attention. So they took 50 of us and brought us to another home in a place called Profonsart, where a doctor and Mrs. Jaffe took care of us. He was a medical doctor, she was a psychologist, and they actually brought us back to life. I mean, imagine that, being taught how to be children again, how to laugh, how to play games, how not to be afraid, go on picnics, play tricks, go to the movies, do all the things, you know, that normal children did. We had to learn that all over again. And in addition to that, most of us had missed our faith, and they also brought us back to Judaism. So this was a very, very good time for us, where we started to become normal, except for me. It was a very, very bad time. And the reason was that as more and more people were coming back from concentration camps, three different people had come back and told my mother that my father was not coming back anymore, that he had died in a concentration camp called Auschwitz. And that was a very big blow to me because I was very attached to my father. Back to my sister now. When my mother was getting better, she was healing, she felt now it was time for my sister to come back with us. And when she started speaking to the people that hid my sister, they were giving her a hard time. They did not want to return my sister. They had grown very, very fond of her and didn't want to give her back. And my mother didn't know what to do, because it's not as if we had the papers. Things were in chaos in those days. Just coincidentally, at the time that she was trying to get my sister back, it turns out that this is my uncle, Murray. He was my father's younger brother, who was here in the United States. He came to Europe during World War II, and he served in the army. When the war was over, he actually started looking for us. And he found my mother just at the time that she was trying to get my sister out. And when she told him about the hard time that she was getting from them, he said, "I will take care of it." And he did. He went to the family, used his authority as an American soldier, and took my sister. And this is a very, very sad part of the story. These people were wonderful, wonderful people, but they didn't want to give up my sister. And when my sister left, they cut off all communications with us. I mean, we were not even able to thank them for what they did for my sister. We were not even able to thank them, you know, for saving her life. Very, very sad. We never were able to get in touch with them again. So when my sister and I, we wound up, my mother put us then in another home. And my mother also had made arrangements with my uncle that when he got back to the United States, he would get the family together, get them to sponsor us, because in those days, my mother, being part of the Polish quarter, could not get into the United States easily unless he was sponsored. And so he got our family, you know, to sponsor us so we could come over. This was the last home that my sister and I were in, a village called Marquin. This is a village now close to the French border, near a big town called Tournai. And the reason I took this picture over here is this is a group of children that were actually being prepared to go to Palestine, which later on became the State of Israel. And this was a religious organization, by the way. And that's me right there. But I want you to pay attention to the staircase over here, the railing, and that door. Because 40 years later, there is the railing, and there is the door, and that's me when I went to revisit that home. That home, there was no one there. It turned out, I believe, to be a monastery. Monks were living there. But we stayed in that home until we got the papers to finally come here to the United States. These are the shipping papers. We came over here on a ship called the USS Marine Tiger. We left Antwerp on April 7th, 1948. And we arrived in New York City on Pier 48 on April 17th, 1948. It was 10 days later. And this is what we looked like. This was at the Passover Seder. That's my sister Lillian. And that's my mother. And that's me, right there. And that's how we got here to the United States. I would like to explain to you what I found out about my father, again, many, many, many years later. Many years later, we went, after the Holocaust Museum opened up in Washington, D.C., we went there to visit and also to find out things, you know, about donating some of our artifacts. It turned out that we were there on a Sunday, and the archive section was closed on a Sunday. And so they sent us to the library to fill out forms. And so when we started talking to the librarian, she started asking all kinds of questions. And when she found out that we were from Belgium and that my father had died in Auschwitz, she got very excited because here we were on a Sunday. And just that previous Thursday, she had received a book from Belgium, listing all the Jews that had been deported to Auschwitz. This is a page of the book. That's what it looks like. It has a bunch of columns. I have a close-up there. And that's the information about my father. His name is Chaim Goldschmidt. That's what gave it away, his birthday. He was born on August 30th, 1903. So I knew that was my father. But the other important information was there. Transport number 16, prisoner number 942. And that was amazing. That was the first documentation that we had about our father. So now I went back to the librarian and I showed her that information. I said, can I pursue this any further? And she said, yes. And she came back with another book called The Auschwitz Chronicle, 1939 to 1945. This was a book that was, of course, originally written in German and then translated into all languages. That book blew my mind. You can't believe how accurate the Germans were, how accurate their records were. They kept daily records from 1939 to 1945 of what transpired in that concentration camp. And so knowing that my father had left in August 1942, I went to the section in 1942. You can see at the top of the page, it says 1942. And I found out that my father arrived on November 3, 1942. And I'm going to read it to you. 1,696 Jews arrive from Malines, this is in Belgium, on two transports. The 16th transport, that's my father's transport. There are 683 men, 21 boys, 89 women, and 29 girls. Talking about being accurate. The 17th, 622 men, 51 boys, 165 women, 36 girls. And then it says, after selection. What does selection mean? When the people arrived in Auschwitz in a section called Birkenau, the people got off the train on a platform. And a German officer would look at them and would point to the left or to the right. One way you were going to die, one way you were going to live. You didn't know that, of course, but they made that selection. So of the 1,696, only 702 men and 75 women from both transports are admitted to the camp. And to be even more accurate, they list the serial numbers, the numbers that were tattooed on the arms. Because when you got into Auschwitz-Birkenau, you lost your identity as a human being, and all you had was a serial number. I looked up these serial numbers, and my father's name was not among them. And so the last sentence says it all. The remaining 919 people are killed in the gas chamber. And that's how I found out the first time they had actual documentation about what had happened to my father. I speak to a lot of children. I speak to schools, Catholic schools, public schools, private schools, high schools, colleges. So in conclusion, I'd like to say the following. My mother and my sister and I, we were lucky. We survived. But unfortunately, until 1995, you know, we never told our stories in public. And now that the older generation is dying, it turns out that I'm very, very glad that I'm speaking. And it's also imperative, you know, that we tell our stories. And one of the reasons that I'm speaking is because of the movie maker, Steven Spielberg, who created the Shoah Foundation, whose purpose it is to video record as many Holocaust survivors as possible. They came to my house, they interviewed me, and it is the young lady who did the interviewing that urged me to start speaking. Now I'm very glad that I do speak, because when I speak to the younger people, I tell them that they are the last generation that will see a live Holocaust survivor. Remember, I am 83 years young, and I'm one of the young ones. So in a few years, all of us will be gone. And I'm very glad that I'm doing this now. So it's important, you know, that we never forget, you know, what happened in Europe during the Nazi era. It's important that it never happens again. However, I'm not so sure that we learned our lesson. Look at the more recent events, you know, of what happened in Rwanda, in Darfur, the genocide over there. It's important that we act against evil and prejudice, intolerance, anti-Semitism, hatred. I'm urging you, please, do not hate. You're doing yourself and other people a disservice. Do not hate. I'm also expressing my personal view, which is, if there had been no hate, there would not have been a Holocaust. We must learn to be tolerant of other people, other faiths, color and background. And the lesson here is you should be decent to all people. So what I'm asking you, the younger generation, is to become righteous human beings who refuse to be indifferent when they see something wrong. Say something, do something, do not be quiet, and don't turn your back. Lastly, it's also very important that we counter the revisionists. These are people who say that the Holocaust never happened. Well, I'm telling you it did happen because I was there. I'm a living witness to it, and I survived it.
Is this the little boy at play? I don't remember growing older. When did they? When did she get to be a beauty? When did he grow to be so tall? Wasn't it yesterday that they